I think the key issue around Hillsborough is the argument and debate that there has been about the late arrival of fans at the ground. It was April the 15th. It was a hot summer's day. It was the end of a cool early spring, so there was still snow on the hills over the Pennines. And people started to arrive from quite an early time in the city. Some of those people would not be going to the game. They would come as families, and some would go shopping while the others went to the match. Those who went off to the game stopped, maybe had a drink at a pub, went and got something to eat, and found their way up to the ground. But one thing that was very clear was that, first of all, there were roadworks on the motorway, and quite a lot of the trains were also delayed. So there was train delays, coach delays, and a lot of the coaches were being searched en route, so they were being pulled in at motorway services. So there was a very gradual build-up at the ground during the 3 hours before the game. By about 2 o'clock, the two central pens immediately behind the goal were already fairly full, and the two main side pens were almost entirely empty. That was because a lot of people who'd arrived early wanted to get their spec right behind the goals. But because there were delays in the rest of the crowd arriving, and quite a lot of them had to walk some considerable distance to the ground from the parks or from the car parks or from the station, it wasn't until about 2:30 that there became a real concentration outside the ground. What we know now, in hindsight, was that the small area that feeds the two sets of turnstiles, that small area had to cope with over 26,000 people going through it. Because unlike any other ground, the access for the stand that runs along the north side of the ground was in the same area as the access for both the seating, the stand at the Leppings Lane end, but also for the Leppings Lane terrace. So almost half of the entire crowd that went into that stadium had to go through that confined area. And it had been long warned, although we didn't know it at the time, it had been long warned within the South Yorkshire Police that that was a problem, a real problem, a bottleneck. And that's exactly what happened at about 2:30 as people started to arrive. It wasn't a case of ticketless fans conspiring to get in, drunken people fighting to get in. All of those have been the myths of Hillsborough. It was purely and simply arrival of fans coming off coaches, coming from the trains, coming from the car parks, in an orderly fashion. And too many people were arriving for the pace of the antiquated turnstiles to take them through. The people at the front couldn't tell the people at the back how crowded it was. So what then happened was that the police outside, now desperate because the crowd had built up, now desperate for some relief of the crush, which looked as though it was going to end in tragedy itself, asked the head police officer, the chief of the ground commander for the day, the match commander for the day, David Duckenfield, asked him if they could open the exit gates to let fans in. And that's exactly what happened. Eventually, after hesitating, the match commander agreed, the exit gate C was opened, and the fans entered through exit gate C, unstewarded, unpoliced. They didn't break step, they walked. And they walked directly opposite that gate to an archway that said standing. They could see through to the ground. And they went down a 1-in-6 gradient tunnel onto the back of two already full pens. Because of lateral fencing and because of perimeter fencing, the crowd that was already in had nowhere to go. So literally, those two central pens, one of which had a license for 1,000 people, the other had a license for 1,100 people, had twice as many people in them. It was like a vice, and it got tighter and tighter, until at the front of one of the pens, pen 3, a barrier broke and people went down under the pressure from behind into a mass of tangled bodies. In both pens people died, but in pen 3 that was where most deaths occurred. The result of that was 96 people died, 400 people were hospitalised, 700 people were injured, and thousands of people were traumatised. Many of their lives have been cut short and many of their working lives have ended prematurely. It was the worst football disaster, worst disaster at a football stadium in British football history. And I think that the issue is that it was always on the cards. It was entirely predictable. It was entirely foreseeable. The way in which grounds had come to be left more or less to go to rack and ruin, the way in which grounds were not safety oriented, the way in which the police were not safety oriented, remains one of the great scandals of Hillsborough to this day. And one example suffices. There is no mention of safety in the entire operational order for the South Yorkshire Police for that day. It was all about crowd control and nothing about crowd safety.